Okay, I'm still getting some problems with interference while using a CNC machine. The last thing that happened while making my super chisel was the spindle moving up in the Z axis. In fact, they moved sort of in that direction. And luckily, because I had the hard limits in place, when that crashed into the top, it just stopped automatically. I also had another problem while cutting where the job just stopped mid-cut.
That could have been from a loose connection somewhere along the wiring.
Something else that happens, which I don't know if this is related or not, is if I stop a job mid-cut, the coordinates change on my software, and in particular the Z-axis always seems to change, and it's never consistent. I've obviously done something wrong with how I've wired this up, so I think I need to investigate this and possibly redesign how this has been put together. The first thing I should mention is that
I don't want this video to become overcomplicated, and I can already admit I haven't filmed everything. So what I'm going to do is just talk about where I think I made mistakes, the things I've changed, and how I think these changes will improve the machine's performance. The first thing was that I used braided earthing strap to shield cheaper cables to and from the VFD.
The problem with this is that the metal braided shield is not insulated from other metal contacts,
as it would be with SY cable, which is what I used in the end.
So I'm going to have to replace all of these.
I think I also created problem areas where I've tried to expand the use of the controller so I could connect to a laser engraver, for example.
And to have the option to switch between this and the VFD. In reality, that's meant I've had to run wires a lot further than what I would otherwise have done.
I also don't feel like I did a great job with the aviation panel mounts, which I use between the controller and both the spindle and stepper motors. Not only was my soldering poor, but the panel mounts made the continuity of the cable shield more complicated to maintain.
So this one here, really what I should have done was use a gland and kept the wire intact, passing through this point and then to my VFD.
I also think I may not have earthed the shielding correctly, all of which should have led back to a single star connection, which I had instead branched.
Everything is connected, but in reality, some things may be looping in ways which may not seem apparent.
Also, I overused power supply units and cluttered the enclosure with wiring. In retrospect, my hard limit switches, the homing proximity sensors, stepper motors and controller could be run from a single 24 volt power supply unit, which would have been a lot easier to wire up.
Which would have been a lot easier to wire up.
The wire up, 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 the wire up.
The VFD I used was poorly documented and made wiring more complicated. That said, I worked out how to program it, but the basic instructions were not well translated in the English manual. I doubt the VFD had an internal EMC or EMI filter, and I may have wired the external one I bought incorrectly. I also didn't place ferrite cores on the wire to the spindle, and the earth terminal on the spindle hadn't been connected to its housing.
Moving on from the VFD, there's other areas that I need to look at. One thing is the voltage dividers that I've used.
I use voltage dividers to step the signal from the homing proximity sensors from 12 down to 5 volts. However, this method doesn't isolate noise returning to the control board.
Okay, so what I'm going to start doing is slowly dismantling the cables and taking things apart so I can have better access to the core wiring, and then I'm going to look at the power management first and then go through the various stages of refitting the VFD and rewiring the homing switches and so on, and hopefully by the end of it this will look a little bit neater and will also work. On a manual for a different VFD, which is available in the UK from RS Tools, there's one section here about wiring up to the motor, EMC guidelines. So this is a bit I don't get. To prevent radiated noise, motor cables should be put in a metal conduit. Alternatively, an armoured or shielded type motor cable should be used. For effective suppression of noise emission, the cable armor or shield must be grounded at both ends to the motor and the inverter ground. I was told that you should only ground at one end, which is, and that's really confused me. These connectors should be as short as possible. Motor cables and signal lines of other control equipment should be at least 30 centimeters apart. So there's lots of information in this actual manual that I can interpret, which is illustrating lots of things I should rethink about. So this is the enclosure since I've done all the rewiring. It looks a lot simpler and there's a few new things inside it. The first thing is that I've taken all the power supply units out and replaced them with one large 24 volt 400 watt unit, and I've also added a opto isolator board which is connected between the controller and the terminal block, which then runs off to the sensors. I've also done a lot of tidying up of the wiring. I think the first thing I'll do is talk about the VFD. I've taken off any shielding which I additionally added, so for example onto this ribbon cable, because I was worried that that might contact something and then create some kind of ground loop. Everything is pretty much the same in here, though I ended up changing the wires to thinner gauge ones for some of the signals. And the main thing I did was I rewired the power coming in, and the ground I took it to the EMI filter earth terminal, and then run it to my terminal block. And this section here is the star connection. Here you can see the ferrite cores. I've got two which the cable loops through. I also put a ferrite core on the main plug and another one on the USB cable. I've removed the aviation panel mount here and replaced it with a GLAN, so the cable is not interrupted and the shielding isn't interrupted. This runs all the way to the spindle. So the spindle is a little bit different now. There's two things that I've done. The armor or shielding, this braided stuff, and the cable, I've actually let it extend out a little bit and clamped the aviation socket to it. But it actually isn't connected to the chassis of the spindle. Just compare it to Nathan's machine. That's connected. So clamping the braid onto this isn't doing what I thought it was going to do. That said, I have used the machine a couple of times since finishing it, and it seems to be performing okay, but only time will tell. The other thing I did was, most of the spindles I've seen have four pins. One is written down as the earth, but there's never been anything connected to it. So what I've done in this case is actually wired a little bit of wire across to a crimp, which I'm putting through the mounting machine screw. And then this connects the housing to ground. If you do ground the housing of the spindle, it will mean that the terminals that you use for doing your probing have to be placed in a specific way. So the ground is then connected to the bit, and the signaling is essentially your touch plate. I think it is important to ground the spindle because in my current setup it's obviously isolated because of the mounting method material. Obviously having a permanent connection makes it a little bit more difficult to move around. At the front of the machine you can see that I've replaced all the aviation panel mounts with the glands, so they're all through cables, there's nothing interrupting that. It's soldered at one end and physically connected to the controller or to the opto isolator on the other end. You can see where I've got rid of the switches for the laser here, and this is where I'll plug in an extractor potentially. The only thing I've kept the same with an aviation panel mount is the probe wire. And the reason I've done this is because I'm planning to use a couple different probing methods and tools, which I'll talk about in another video. I've also changed the wire that runs to all the hard limit switches around the machine to a continuous wire, and there's a gland there just to stop it from being pulled out. I really wanted to keep the display panel at the front of the machine, plus this selector switch or toggle switch to go from the PWM signal on the controller to the potentiometer. I've created solder connections for a lot of things instead of the screw terminals where I can, just to create better connection. I did swap a lot of the cables to just thinner stuff. I realised I didn't really need to use such chunky wiring as I was using before. I just twisted it and made sure it's clear from everything else. And then here we've got the isolation board, opto isolator, opto coupler, 24 volts comes in. I think there must be some kind of resistors in there, because when I take a reading from this side, it's all dropped from 24 to about 8. Okay, so on its untriggered state, it's at 0.45 volts. And when the sensor is triggered, it jumps up to 5. Also 3D printed this bit at the bottom here to hold this in place. It's not great, but at least it won't flip over or get pulled. And I made a similar thing for the box voltage regulator there, which I've connected to the power supply unit, and it's dropping the voltage down to 12 volts so I can turn the LEDs on, which I put in a while ago. This is the 24 volt relay. So one side is going to the hard limit switches while the other is going towards the socket for use with the coolant, although it would be a lot better if we had something which could function as a switch for an extractor, to be honest, and that could turn on and off, although in theory you could just wire this up instead. So this is the main terminal block where the power comes in and then goes to the contactor and fuse, allows the power to go to the rest of the system. While filming, I did a bit more reading about this particular cable. I'm not sure if it can be deemed as a shielding, but I think it will work if I do create a physical connection between the metal and the metal underneath. The other thing which I should have done was used galvanized steel as the backing plate here, not aluminium, because this can oxidize and it can affect how electricity flows through it.
Flows through it.
This is the manual for the VFD I was considering buying, but I didn't particularly want to spend nearly 150 quid on it just yet, but maybe I will still. But there's a lot of really interesting information and it's still worth a read. Here it says, if using an external EMC input filter, it must be mounted under the drive and connected directly to the line supply via an unshielded cable. You can see how they've shielded the cables. It's literally screwed directly onto the backing plate by the looks of it. For cables 5 and 6, the shielding must be connected to earth at both ends. Shielding must be continuous. So that's essentially what I've learned and the changes I've made to the electronics of the CNC machine and its controller. I've been cutting stuff out on and off now for several weeks, and I've not noticed any unusual behaviour. So it seems the changes I've made to the controller have made a difference. But I still need to fine tune the steps, acceleration and nut block tensioning for the Z, Y and X axes, which is what I'll do in the next video. So that leaves me with the final thing to say, which is thanks again for watching, and you'll catch me then.